Okay, we're holding over here by the entrance into Tisha B'Av, only a few days away, unfortunately. And everybody knows the famous words of Chazal that ask, Mibnei ma charev Beis HaMikdash? Why was the Beis HaMikdash destroyed? The Gemara says, Ba'is Rishon, because of the Gimel Chamurais, Gilarayish, Shvichis Damim, and Avodah Zarah. And then the Gemara says, but they did tshuva, they came back to the land, and that ended. What about the Bayis Sheni, the second Beis HaMikdash, as we know, because Sinas Chinam. The Gemara points out that Sinas Chinam is keneged, the Gimel Chamurais, it's equal to the three terrible ones, so much so that the Beis HaMikdash has not yet been rebuilt. Obviously, which means that we haven't done the tshuva that is necessary. When a person is sick and they go to the doctor, so the doctor's job is that he must examine the patient that is in front of him. He listens to what they have to say, what's aching them and hurting them, what their conditions are. He runs his examinations and his tests and the blood tests, the x-rays, the MRIs, whatever they need. And when he begins to identify what the issue is in this patient, then he can begin to heal them in the proper way. Give them the right medication, he'll give them the right diagnosis, he'll send them the right places to go, all the things that they need in order to, Be'ez Hashem, get healthy. There are things in this world called spiritual maladies. As the Rabbeinu Yonah writes in Shari Tshuva, there's Cholei HaNefesh. There are sicknesses that exist inside of one's nefesh, inside of their soul. And in order to correct the Cholei HaNefesh, the sickness that's in the soul, we have to identify what exactly is that sickness. What is the cause and the root of how that sickness, that machler, Rachman Litzlan, came about in the nefashis, in the neshamas of Klal Yisrael. And once that we can identify the source, we can see what it is that's going on beneath, underneath all the layers of Klal Yisrael, then we can begin the tikkun, then we can begin to make the progress and the corrections that we need in order to heal the Jewish people from all of their suffering and their pain. If the Gemara tells us that the reason that the Bayis Sheni was destroyed is because something is called Sinas Chinam, senseless hatred, whatever exactly that means we have to identify the source and the root and the cause of this terrible machla, this spiritual malady. And then once we understand what it is, we can begin to be mesaken to fix it up. And in that way, Be'ez Hashem, the gullus that Klal Yisrael finds itself in for over 2,000 years already, can finally have the refuah shlema, can have the healing that it's waiting for. So I saw a very beautiful pshat based on in Parshas Pinchas, which we had a few weeks ago. Moshe Rabbeinu, we know, was condemned to finish his life in the midbar, in the wilderness. HaKadosh Baruch Hu told him, you're not allowed to come into Eretz Yisrael. And try as Moshe Rabbeinu might, he davened and he pleaded with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem said, sorry, you're not coming in to Eretz Yisrael. And the Pasuk tells us, interestingly enough, Vayomer Hashem al Moshe, Hashem says to Moshe, Ale el har ha'avorim hazeh, I want you to come up to this mountain, Ure'eyas ha'aretz, and look at the land, Eretz Yisrael, asher nesati livnei Yisrael, that I'm going to give to Bnei Yisrael, to the children of Israel. V'ra'isa isa, you'll see it, v'nesafta el amecha, gam ata kasher nesaf aron achicha. Once that you glance at Eretz Yisrael, and you see the land that you're never going to get to, then you will expire, you will die, and you'll be gathered to your people, just like your brother, Aaron HaKohen. And Rashi asks over here right away, why does HaKadosh Baruch Hu bring Moshe Rabbeinu up to the mountain? Because Moshe began thinking, look, there's this whole parsha, B'nai Tzlavchad. They have no real portion in the land because their father died without any sons. They go to Moshe Rabbeinu, they complain. Moshe goes to Hashem and he says, they're right, they deserve a chelik, a portion in the land. So Moshe began to think, everyone's going to get a chelik in Eretz Yisrael. And maybe HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to rescind his decree, and I'm also going to be zeichah to go to Eretz Yisrael. So Hashem said, no, Moshe, I didn't take away my gzera. It is oimed befanav, it's standing in its place, and you are not going to Eretz Yisrael. Ask the Rogachov Rav. So what is the HaKadosh Baruch Hu doing with Moshe? He says, Moshe, guess what? You're not going to Eretz Yisrael. You're never going to go to Eretz Yisrael. Do me a favor. Why don't you go up to that big tall mountain over there and just look out on the land that you will never ever be able to walk and step foot in. Think anyone here has been to Eretz Yisrael? Yeah, of course. Who hasn't been to Eretz Yisrael? Moshe Beinu Davin, you'll see in Parshat Haschan on 516 tefillos, waiting to go to Eretz Yisrael, begging and pleading with Hashem. And Hashem said, no, you can't go in. And we, our parents, I should say, take their credit card, they run that card for El Al, send you off to Eretz Yisrael, seminary, or you go for a Sukkot, or a Pesach, or a summer vacation, and you're there in the land that Moshe Rabbeinu was never zeichah to step foot in. The Vilna Gaon wanted desperately to go to Eretz Yisrael, and he tried to go twice, and both times bizarre things happened which he was withheld from going into Eretz Yisrael, and he took it as a siman min hashamayim. Hashem does not want him to leave Vilna. He's not going to go to Eretz Yisrael. But he wanted to. And we get to go like that, no problem. Your passport, by the time you're 6 months old, is stamped 3 times with your visits to Eretz Yisrael. Maybe some of you. So what's HaKadosh Baruch Hu doing over here? He knows Moshe's not going to go to Eretz Yisrael. No matter how much Moshe's going to plead, he's not going in. He says, Moshe, go up to the mountain and just take a look at that land that you'll never, ever get to go to. Is HaKadosh Baruch Hu Chas V'Shalom a sadist? Did you ever get there in AP English? Yeah? What's a sadist? Well, everyone's looking with blank looks. It's someone who purposely does things to another person to torture them. Is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God forbid, a sadist? That he looks to torture Moshe Rabbeinu and tell him, you're never going to go to Eretz Yisrael. You'll never step foot inside of it. Why don't you just take a look and see what you're not going to have? What, to torture Moshe? To make him feel bad? To make him feel that he's losing? And again, the Gemara says, what was Moshe Rabbeinu wanting to go to Eretz Yisrael so badly for? For shawarma? You can get shawarma in Los Angeles. He wanted a falafel. He wanted to go ziplining over Eilat. Why did he want to go to Eretz Yisrael so badly? He wanted to go to Eretz Yisrael. The Gemara tells us because in Eretz Yisrael there's more mitzvahs, there's more kedusha, and Moshe would be on a whole different darga, a different level than he was. So ask the Rogachov, why is HaKadosh Baruch Hu seemingly so harsh to Moshe Rabbeinu that he's causing him to eat his heart out, as they say, and look at the land, just glance at it, that he'll never be able to be a part of? It's like when somebody comes back from some exotic vacation, you know in a zillion years you'll never go on that vacation. And they're showing you all their pictures, one after the other, with big smiles on their face. Look, we did this and we did this. You're supposed to be happy. Or maybe by the end of this year we'll see that you are supposed to be happy, but you're supposed to be happy. You know, this person goes on this vacation every summer and their family goes over here and they go over there. And you can't go on these vacations. Either you're too frum for your family to go to such a place, or it's cost too much money to go. Either one, you're never going to go. So you're looking at the pictures. Is my friend trying to be cruel to me? She's talking about it, blabbing away. Oh, we did this, then we ate in this restaurant, we stayed in this hotel. Yeah, it was only 4.5 stars. Okay, we suffered anyway, we made it. But she's trying to hurt you, trying to make you feel bad that you can have the same opportunity. What is HaKadosh Baruch Hu doing to Moshe Rabbeinu? So the Rogachov answers what he does, which we'll see, but I was thinking that it's based upon the following part, which is just several psukim later in the Torah. HaKadosh Baruch Hu informs Moshe Rabbeinu, you're not going into Eretz Yisrael. Which means 40 years of leading Klal Yisrael through the Midbar is coming to an end. You're not the one that's going to take them. Imagine you're the captain of a ship, and you got the whole crew and all of the passengers on the ship through the most harrowing storm that you could imagine. Lightning, thunder, the ship was bobbling up and down. It looked like you're going to capsize and drown. And this captain stands by the steering wheel the whole time, and he's ordering all of the shipmates around, and he steers them clear into safety. And then at the end, they pull out some young guy over there, 40, 60, 80 years younger than the captain, and they say, "Listen, captain, it was a long journey already. You're very tired. You can't be the one that's going to take us into the docks, and everyone's going to celebrate that we finally got to dry land. We'll let this little whippersnapper over here do it." Says HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Moshe Rabbeinu, you're not taking Klal Yisrael into Eretz Yisrael. Somebody has to, though. So Moshe said, "Okay, how about my children? Let my children, they've watched me lead Klal Yisrael all these years, they can lead them in." Hashem says, "No, your children are not Zeicher. They don't merit to be the future leaders of Klal Yisrael." You know what, though? Yoshua ben Nun, your trusty Eved and your servant, who has been Yoshev ba'ayalah, he sat in your tents all of these years, learning your Torah, defending you, guarding the charge that you've given him. He's the one that is going to take all of the Yidden into Eretz Yisrael. Now, Moshe, in order for him to take every single one of the Jews that's left into Eretz Yisrael, you need to give him something called smicha. And the smicha is not just going to be rabbinical ordination over here. Rather, you're going to imbue him with all of the koyach, the strength and the abilities and the insights that you have as a leader. You are going to pass it over to Yoshua ben Nun so that he can be manhik, he can lead Klal Yisrael the way that you led Klal Yisrael. And the pasuk says, Vayoyma Hashem al Moshe, Hashem said to Moshe, "Kach lecha es Yoshua ben Nun, take for yourself Yoshua ben Nun, isha sheruach boy, that has a spirit inside of him, v'samachta es yadecha alav, and you should rest your hand upon him." And he had to stand him up in front of Elazar, Akoyin, in front of all of Klal Yisrael. Imagine Moshe Beinu. He wants to lead them, he wants to go to Eretz Yisrael, but he can't. So he's appointing his young apprentice, his student to be, it's like a Rosh Yeshiva who's been leading Yeshiva 40 years. Usually when the Rosh Yeshiva dies, that's when the next in line becomes Rosh Yeshiva. But he's told by the board of trustees of that Yeshiva, "You know, Rosh, you're already about 90 years old. I think your time has come to an end leading this Yeshiva. You know that young Rebbe over there who was your student when you were just a Rebbe in Yeshiva? He's going to become the new Rosh Yeshiva, and you have to appoint him in front of the entire Yeshiva. As a matter of fact, the entire community is going to come out and watch you, great Rosh Yeshiva with the long frock, appoint him as the next Rosh Yeshiva." And Moshe Rabbeinu he's informed what he has to do, how much energy he has to give him, how much kedusha he has to give to him. And then it says, "Vayismaych es yadav alav." He placed his hands on Yoshua, v'yatzaveyu kasher dibra Hashem b'yad Moshe, and he commanded him just as HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Moshe Rabbeinu to do. Says Rashi over here, seemingly, sometimes words in the Chumash seem like they're not saying anything, no chiddush, nothing novel or new, but Rashi points out, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Moshe to give your smicha, to rest your hand on top of Yoshua's head, he said, "Vayismach yadecha," place your hand on his head. When Moshe Rabbeinu on his own comes to give over the smicha, to give the brachas to Yoshua, it says, "Vayismach es yadov," he placed both of his hands on Yoshua's head. Says Rashi, "Ba'ayin yofe yoyser v'yoyser mimashin itstave." He did it with an ayin yafe, with a good eye. Yoyser, beyoyser, much more than HaKadosh Baruch Hu commanded him to do. Moshe Rabbeinu is giving over the powers of being the manig of Klal Yisrael to Yoshua. And it's bitter sweet for Moshe Rabbeinu because it means I cannot go to Eretz Yisrael. 40 years of my life dedicated to Klal Yisrael, I put up with all the headaches and all the complaints and all of the narishkeit. I defended them, I davened for them, I brought them Torah min HaShemayim, man from the heavens, the Ber Mirim follows around, I protect them against their enemies. I did that, Moshe Rabbeinu. And now I have to give it over to Yoshua. When I give it over to Yoshua, I'm giving it over Ba'ayin Yofeh. With a beautiful looking eye, Yoyser v'Yoyser much more than HaKadosh Baruch Hu commanded me to do. Why? Because Moshe Rabbeinu did not live for Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu lived for the Ribbono Shel'Olam. And when you live for the Ribbono Shel'Olam, the only thing that matters to you is to make sure that your actions are Mekadesh Shem Shemayim, which means that you bring glory to the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu in this world. And if in fact Hashem's leaving you in the Midbar because that's the punishment that was incurred for hitting the rock and not talking to the rock, and if it's true that Yahushua is going to be the one to lead Klal Yisrael into Eretz Yisrael, since all of this is the plan of the Ribbono Shel'Olam, and of course I want that the Shekhinah should dwell in this world in the best possible way, I'm not thinking about myself, says Moshe. I'm thinking about the Shekhinah HaKadosha, and I'm thinking about what is best for Klal Yisrael. And therefore I will give both hands, Ba'ayin Yofeh, Yoyser v'Yoyser, much more than HaKadosh Baruch Hu even commanded me to do. The Moshe Eved Ne'eman, the trustful and the faithful Eved that he was to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in the most difficult times of his life, where it's only normal that a person would be jealous, a person would be frustrated, they would be sad and disappointed. Only natural for a person to be like that. Moshe said, it's not about me. Whatever is best for the glory of the Shekhinah and for the continuity of Klal Yisrael, I'm 110% behind it, and I put all of my heart and all of my soul into that, and I give Yoshua the greatest bracha of all, but I in Yofeh, Yoyser, v'Yoyser, much more than Hashem wants from me. This, the Rogachover says, is the pshat that Hashem brought Moshe up to the mountain and told him to look out at Eretz Yisrael. Chas v'chalila that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is a sadist. God forbid to say such things. Chas v'shalom that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted to instill tsar and agmas nefesh into the heart of Moshe Rabbeinu. Chas v'shalom. But he knew that Moshe is the quintessential Ayin Yofeh, the good eye that's going to look out for the best of Klal Yisrael. And therefore he said, Moshe, I want your holy glance to peer upon Eretz Yisrael. I want you to look at every corner that you possibly can. Look at where the Makom HaMikdash will be. Look at Sfas. Look at Meiron. I want you to see all of the Mekaymes HaKadoshim. And I want you to inflect and infuse your Kedusha, your best and longest yearnings and feelings for Klal Yisrael's success living in Eretz Yisrael. I want you to pour it out onto the land itself. Only you, Moshe, can do something like that. Because you, Moshe, don't care about yourself. You care about the glory of the Shekhinah. You care about the sanctity of Eretz Yisrael. And you care about the Hemshech, the continuation of Klal Yisrael being the Am HaNivchar, the chosen nation that is going to dwell in Eretz Yisrael. So Moshe goes up to the mountain, no anger, no pain, no frustration with HaKadosh Baruch Hu and his ways. He went Ba'ayin Yofeh with this beautiful glance. Yoyser v'Yoyser, even more than HaKadosh Baruch Hu dreamed of. And he infused all of Eretz Yisrael with that Kedusha that was emanating from the Heilige Neshama, the holy soul of Moshe. There's a beautiful maaseh with Shlomo Zalman Auerbach years ago. A young married couple came to him and he said, Rosh Yeshiva, we are currently looking between two different deals, two apartments in Yerushalayim that we're planning on buying. And everything is pointing in the direction of this particular one. The price is right, the location is good, the availability is now. And it looks like we're probably going to get this one. And I just came to the Rosh Yeshiva to ask for a bracha that everything should go through well and this should be the apartment that is proper for me and my wife to raise a family in and to grow in. And Shlomo Zalman Auerbach said, where is the apartment? They told him over there in Yerushalayim, in whatever neighborhood it was, based Yisrael. No, what street is it on? Told him, the street Rechayiv this, whatever street it was. Which floor is it on? Tells him it's the second floor upon. Okay. What's the number? Whatever number, 12. Okay, very good. When are you going to the apartment again to meet your broker there to close the deal? He says, we're going tomorrow. Shlomo Zalman says, what time are you going to meet him? 9:00 in the morning. Very good. I give you a bracha. Everything should be well. You should have siyata d'shemaya there. You should have bracha there. Kedusha there. Only simchas. Go. Take the apartment. Thank you. He answers, amen. And he goes off. Next morning, this young couple shows up at the apartment to meet the broker. And who is standing in front of the apartment building? None other than the great Pesach Hador, the Rosh Yeshiva of Shlomo Zalman Auerbach. The couple is perplexed. What is the Yeshiva doing here? He says, I came to take a look. I want to make sure the apartment is as good as you say that it is. The broker shows up and he sees Rosh Shlomo Zalman Auerbach there. They quickly let everybody in. And Rosh Shlomo Zalman begins walking through the entire apartment, looking in each and every single room that there is. In Eretz Yisrael, it doesn't take that long to look through an apartment. But he went, taking his precious time. The kitchen, the dining room, the bedrooms, the marpeset, the porch, any room that there was, the machzan, everywhere he looked. And he turned to the young couple and he said, this is going to be the dear of the apartment that you live in, that in Yitzhak Hashem you're going to raise children and a family in. I wanted to see with my own eyes, to give over my heartfelt brachos into this dear, this apartment, that it should be the best siyata d'shamayim that you could possibly have over here. This is the life of Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu doesn't think about himself. He doesn't worry about his covet. He doesn't worry about his shame or his embarrassment. He's an Eved. He does what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. And Hashem wants me to go up to the mountain so that I should infuse Eretz Yisrael with all of the Kedusha that is there? Impossible that this Ayin Yofet, that this good eye, is not going to be able to see only but the best. A beautiful book was just printed. It's the biography of Rav Meir Zlotowitz. He was the originator and the founder of Art Scroll. Fascinating individual, many lessons to learn from his life. One of his chashev midas that he had was, he was always very close to Rabbanim. He had the schus as a bocher to learn by Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal, and he remained close to Rav Moshe all the years that Rav Moshe was alive, and then he became very close to Rav Moshe's children, Rav Dovid and Rav Reuven Feinstein. He had a friend, and his friend's name was Rav Nosson Muller. And Rav Nosson Muller lived, I think, in Chicago, perhaps, and he said, listen, we're making a suda for the yard site of Rav Moshe, and tomorrow night is the yard site, and I was wondering, perhaps you have a maisa, a story that nobody knows about Rav Moshe. So Rav Zalowitz says, you want to hear a maisa? I'll tell you a maisa shahaya that I witnessed with my own eyes. Nobody knows the story. He said, I was a bacha learning in yeshiva, and one day I see a group of prominent rabbanim come to the base midrash, and they're hovering around Rav Moshe. And they're handling with him, they're talking to him and learning, they're discussing things with him. Looks very serious. So I walked over to the one of the Rabbanim that was there, and I asked, what's going on over here? So he said, we have a chalitza ceremony to do. Chalitza, you know, there's a mitzvah called Yibum. And if the woman doesn't want to do Yibum, she does what's called chalitza with the shoe. It's a very rare ceremony. It doesn't take place that often. And they wanted Rav Moshe to reside over the ceremony. So Meir Zlatowitz asked, is it okay if I come along? They said, sure, come along, accompany your Rebbe, go ahead. They drive through the streets of New York and they come to this old, dilapidated, broken down building somewhere in the Lower East Side. And they park their cars and Rav Meir Zlatowitz goes up with his Rebbe, Rav Feinstein, and they come to a house and the door opens up and there is an aged, decrepit, old man who looks more dead than he does alive, like a hovel, disheveled and a mess. They come into the house and Rav Moshe begins explaining to this old man what the mitzvah of Yibum and Chalitza is and what they're going to do with this special shoe. And he says to the man, since the shoe has to go on your foot, I have to make sure that there's no chatzitza, there's no blemishes that's going to block the skin of your foot from being inside of the shoe. So I need you to take off your shoe and your sock, and I need to examine your foot to make sure that there's nothing on there and we can start with the procession. So all the Rabbanim are standing around, and the man takes off his shoe and takes off his sock, and suddenly the room is filled with the most awful, hideous smell that anyone has ever smelled in their entire life. And they look at this old man's foot and it is covered in blisters and pus, and the smell is so offensive, people cannot, not only can they not look at the foot, they can't even breathe. Some of the Rabbanim excuse themselves, they had to walk out of the room to catch their breath. Rav Moshe Feinstein doesn't even flinch. He walks over to the man and he picks up the man's foot in his hand and he turns to one of the other Rabbanim and he says, please bring me a bowl with a towel and some water and soap. I need to clean his foot. And the Gadol HaDor of Moshe Feinstein sits in this room where everybody else is repulsed by the situation, and he cradles the man's foot in his hand and he's scrubbing away all of the pus, all of the blisters, gently, not to hurt the man. And when he ascertains that everything is in the best possible way and there's no longer a chatzitza, there's no longer anything that's blocking, he says, now we are ready to start the ceremony. Rav Nosson Muller is on the other end of the line and he says, Rav Meir, that's perfect. That's exactly the trait and the need of Rav Moshe that I'm planning on speaking about tomorrow night. Perfect, Maisa. Fast forward several years, Rav Meir Zlatowitz passes away. Could even be that it was around the same year. Rav Meir passes away and Rav Nosson Muller gets on a plane from Chicago to New York to go be Menachem Avel to the Mishpacha. And he's there in the Shiva house and he says, I must tell you a Maisa that your father told me about him and Rav Moshe. He was so close to him. And he tells over the Maisa. And he says the next day after the Yortzeit meal had taken place, I sent Rav Meir a beautiful text message thanking him for sharing that story with me because it was perfect, exactly what the Olam wanted to hear. And then he pulled out his phone by the Shiva house and he said, let me read you the text message that your father sent back to me. And he said, that scene will never leave my mind. It was a mitzvah and Rav Meisha handled that person's feet as if they were tashmishei Kedusha as if they were items of Kedusha, of holiness and sanctity. As he says over those words, Rabbi Muller hears somebody is softly crying in the room. And he looks to see if it's the children of Rav Meir, not them. And he sees a group of Rabbanim and he realizes one of the Rabbanim is crying. And he looks and he sees that it's none other than Rav Reuven Feinstein, the son of Rav Moshe, who had never heard the Maisa before. A group of Rabbanim, all in the same house, all there for the mitzvah of Chalitza. Rav Moshe is the venerable sage, the Rosh Hashiva, the Gadol Hador. Everybody's holding their nose, they're walking out of the house, they can't stand it. Rav Moshe with the Ayin Yofa Yoyser B'Yoyser, much more than HaKadosh Baruch Hu commanded. He didn't see smelly, dirty feet. He didn't smell the pus and the blisters, excuse me, what was coming out of this man's foot. With his beautiful glance that he had, he saw Tashmishe Kedusha, items that are used for Kedusha, for holiness. He saw the world of Hashem. He saw an opportunity to be Mekadosh Shem Shemayim. And that's why he was Moshe. He was the leader of Klal Yisrael in his time. There's a Mishnah in Pirkei Avos. I'm sure that you are all familiar with it. Rav Yochanan ben Zakkai, the great Tana of the Mishnayis, came to his Talmidim, Amalev, and he said to them, Tzu'u ra'u, go and take a look. Eizuhu derech yeshara sheyidbak ba'adam. What is the derech yeshara, what is the straight path that a person should cling to? When you find the right things in life, you have to cling to them. When you find the wrong things in life, you have to run away from them, like the Ramchal says, kebareach min ha'esh, like a person that is running away from fire. You never saw a person stand around as the fire is moving in their direction. I had a student once who was traveling in the direction of Vegas, I think, for Shabbos. He was driving away from Vegas, trying to get back to L.A., This is about a year or two ago in the summertime. There was a tremendous fire in that area. And it got so bad that the fire started coming up onto the freeway. Everybody was abandoning their cars and running for their lives. Not that the fires of Las Vegas and the tomb is any better than that. But the fires that were coming onto the freeway, they were running for their lives. Says of Yochanan ben Zakkai, go and look for the Derech Yishar, the right path. And Yidbak Ba, you should cling to it. And he goes to his Talmidim, but the first one is Rabbi Eliezer. Rabbi Eliezer Oimer, Ayin Tovah. A person should live their life with an Ayin Tovah, a good eye. What does it mean, a good eye? Now I want to go through some of the Mefarshim over here. Each one is enlightening. The Rav de Bartanur says, what is an Ayin Tovah? Mistapek b'mashe yeshloi. He is satisfied with that which he has. Ve'einoi mevakish devarim yeserim. He doesn't look for things that are extra and things that he doesn't have already in his life. He's completely satisfied with what HaKadosh Baruch Hu has given him. But here's the punchline of the Rav. Ve'einoi mekane kesheroye sheyesh lechaveirov yoyser mimenu. And he doesn't get jealous when he sees that his friend has yoyser, has more than him. Now I'm translating it, he doesn't and his friend. But of course, she doesn't get jealous when she sees that her friend has more than her. What is Ayin Tovah when a person examines their life and they see everything is good? My parents are good. The way that I look is good. The school that I went to is good. The seminar I went to is good. Shidduchim is, everything is good. And I'm not jealous of another person, no matter how much better their life sometimes seems to be. That's the Rav. We'll see more. Tiferes Yisrael writes, Mistapik b'ma'at sheyesh lo, similar, he's happy with even the little bit that he has. But listen to these words. V'sameach b'hatzlochos chaveroi. She rejoices in the success of her friend. V'eino mekana, she doesn't get jealous of what the friend has. V'eino doyeng, she doesn't worry. V'eino kayes, and she doesn't get angry. Bracha is a kala? Really, bracha is a kala. Interesting. Surprised. Who would marry? Say such a thing. It's bracha. Yeah, of course, we went to school together. She's a kala. I am sameach behatzlochas chaveroi. Somebody has more than me right now. I rejoice for them. I sing and I dance for them. I'm so excited for them. I'm not jealous of them. Chas v'chalila. I'm not a jealous person. Because jealousy over another person's situation in life brings me to daiga. I start worrying. V'koyes, and I can get so angry, says the Tiferes Yisrael. We'll see more. The Machz of Vitri and the Meiri write, Sha'ayin Tovah, Shein Nena, listen to this. Listen to what he says. The Meiri writes, Shein Nena B'Tovas Zulasai. Not only am I not jealous of what somebody else has, not only am I satisfied with what HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives me, not only don't I worry and I don't get angry because somebody else has more hatzlacha, more success, more bracha, better things going on in their life, because I have such an ayin tovah, says the Meiri, you actually are nehena, you benefit from the good things that your friend ends up getting from the Ribbono Shel Olam. You have hanah. You have pleasure. I see somebody else that has bracha in their life. I'm so satisfied. Somebody else got into the seminary that I've been dreaming of since I was in fourth grade, and they denied me. I am so happy for that girl. Yeah. I'm so happy for that girl that she got into that seminary. Okay, I'll go to Misaris Rachel. It's going to be okay. You'll still get married. You have nothing to worry about. There's still plenty of shidduchim that are waiting for you. Says the Meiri. The Meiri is a Rishon. The Meiri is a Rishon. We're talking about from the times of the Rambam, from Rashi, from Rabbeinu Yonah. And he writes, I don't mean anything, by the way, about the name. That's just the one that popped into my head. Says the Meiri, when you have an ayin tovah, when you look good upon other people, you know what happens? You are so happy for them. You are nehene. You enjoy their simcha. I remember when I was becoming what they call in the world of yeshivas an altar bacher. Altar bacher means that you're no longer 23, 24, 25 years old. You hit Shem Hashem 26. So you're an altar bacher, and the boys that are crawling around in diapers in yeshiva, they're getting married, and you're still an altar bacher, you're not married yet. And yes, I tried to have an ayin tovah, but it gets very painful and lonely up on top. One day I decided, you know what? I can't imagine that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to reward me just because I'm getting jealous of everybody else that's 5 years younger than me and getting married. Why don't I work on Ayin Tovah? And from now on, I decided that when I see a Bachur who becomes a Chassan, and if I am invited to that Chassana of the Bachur, instead of sitting there and saying, this guy, you don't know what he does in the dormitories, this guy became a Chassan, I can't believe it. Instead of all my tainas and all my complaints and all my daiga and kas to the Ribbono Shel Olam, I'm going to be sameach v'hatzlachas chaveiro for the success of my friends. And I worked, it was not easy, I worked and I worked and I worked. And instead of getting upset, I became a happy person for everyone that was getting engaged. I started going to chasanas and I would dance with people, sometimes not even my greatest of friends, dance to be mesamech them. And the last chasana that I went to before I myself became a chasan, they couldn't pull me off the dance floor when I was dancing with this chasan who got married. If you have an ayin tovah, you are in Nehenna, you enjoy other people's simcha. You're delighted for them. You are enraptured by them. HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent them a bracha. You're so happy. Then he writes further. This is the Riben Shushan. Vayismach betoivis chaveroi. Vatzachosim, the same idea. You rejoice for them. But then the Machzor Vitri ends with, he says like this. Shemitoich shein eino itzora. Because that your eye is not tzora, it's not narrow or stingy or looking bad, and you are not jealous of your friend, you will be at peace with the other person. Why is there a terrible disease in Klal Yisrael called Sinas Chinam? We hate another Jew for what? Because you hate another Jew. Kinearly, in my humble opinion, for whatever it is worth, there's something called Ayin Tovah, a good eye. And the good eye is one that sees the good things coming to your friends and you are happy for them. You rejoice with them. You are nehenna, you benefit and you have pleasure from their simcha. You're happy with whatever it is, like Moshe Rabbeinu. You think it was easy to lose the schus to go into Eretz Yisrael, but he was mekabel. He accepted, that's what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. I have no tainas, no complaints against the Ribbono Shel Olam. As a result, he goes up to the mountain, he looks at Eretz Yisrael, only thinks the best. When I look at another person, another Yid, a friend of mine, and I see the good things that are going on in their life, yes, the natural state of the human condition is right away, oh, she got into BJJ? Are you kidding me? Are you kidding? You know that she... Okay, I would never tell Remsen Dave. I saw. Says the Torah, that is Sinas Chinam, because you have an Ayin Ra. Why do you have to judge? Why do you have to have tainas and complaints? Why do you have to undermine the success and the Hatzlacha of another young lady? Why do you have to get jealous of your cousin who you saw by the last family Chasana, walking around with all of her nice clothing and jewelry, like she's some Colin, she's only 15 years old, strutting around like she owns the place. Leave her alone. Makes her happy. She's a good girl. She's a simchatic person. What, you're going to sit through the whole chasana? Oh, gosh, I hate that cousin. How could a person do such a thing? Say Chazal, Ayin Tovah is the derech yeshara sheyidbog ba'adam, that a person should cling to with all of their life. Why? Because then you will be happy with yourself, and then you will be happy for everyone else, says the Machzor Vitri, and then yesh b'sholayim ima, you will live in peace with everybody around you, and you won't come to hate another person. Sinas Chinam means for no reason. Whenever a person is enveloped in midos ra'os, in these terrible traits of ayin ra, of the bad negative eye that cause you to get angry and to be jealous and to worry all the time, why doesn't Kodesh Baruch Hu do the same thing to them that he does to me like he does to them? You're not living in the Olam HaEmes, in the world of truth. The world of truth is the world of the Ribbono Shel'olam. The world of the Ribbono Shel'olam is the world that we have. Whatever He has given me or not given me, that's what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. So if I go into a world of complaining and I allow myself to get angry and frustrated and I start bashing this person behind their back, rolling my big eyes so everybody knows what I really think about Mrs. BJJ over there and her iPhone. So I'm now living in the world of sheker, of falsehood, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is geyzer. You'll go to this seminary, she's gonna go here. She comes back from seminary, she gets off the plane, and the chassan is waiting at the airport. And you have a few more days, or a few more weeks, or a few more months. You'll have to wait till your chassan comes to the front door like a mensch and picks you up and takes you on your first date at Coffee Bean or some other place. A person who lives in the world of Ayin Ra is living in a world not of the Ribbono Shel'olam. They're living in their own world of daiga, of kas, of anger, of all the different things. And that is hatred of another Jew for no reason at all. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu already decided that's the way that it's supposed to be. If we want to be mesaken, to fix up this terrible, terrible chait of sinas chinam, there is only one way. And that is that we must begin to develop the Ayin Tovah that exists inside each and every one of us. We learn from Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu lost all of his dreams, but he lived only for the Ribbono Shel'olam. So when you live for Hashem, it's all about Kiddush Shem Shemayim. It's not about what I want. And therefore, I can see the good in every person, in every situation. And the Mishnah tells us over here, the derech yishara sheyidbak ba'adam is that you must have an eye in toiva, an eye that is happy for others, and be happy with what you have. If a person will examine all the brachas, when, you know, my children, they board by the Grossmans, Rabbi Grossman's Atzal and his wife, and after Rabbi Grossman was nifter, my children would come home after yeshiva at night, and the Rebbetzin would sit with them almost every single night and just tell them maisa after maisa about Reb David Zatzal and about their life together. And she said that there were many times in their lives that they didn't have money to put food on the table. And she would get a little bit nervous. Where is it going to come from? And Rabbi Grossman Zatzal would say to his wife, Rachi, look how much we have to be thankful for. And she would look at him, and he would say, look at our family. Look at our children. And then he would begin to go through each and every one of the children that HaKadosh Baruch has given them. And then he would say all of his son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws. And then he would go through all of the grandchildren that were there as well. And after he would conclude the entire list of all of the brachas they would have, and he would say, look how much we have to be thankful for. If Hashem gave us all of that, certainly He'll give us the means that we need to put the food on the table as well. Ayin Tovah. Sameach bechelko, to be happy with what you have, not to be jealous with what others have. Because if you are, then you'll always be trying to find something that's wrong with another person, and that's how you're going to come to this terrible tragedy of the chait of sinas chinam, and then the world is going to continue to go along the way that it is, and we're going to live in galus another year and another year and another year, rachmanu litzlan, because we can't find the refuah to the makkah, the healing ointment to the tremendous pain that we are in, which is Ayin Tovah, gets rid of sinas chinam. I want to leave you off with a maisa. I hope that it hasn't gone viral yet, as they say, because somebody was in contact with me from a girls' camp. They needed a maisa. They wanted a dvar Torah for their camp. And as soon as we started telling over what the story was, we heard that story already. But hopefully in California they didn't hear the story yet. There's a yeshiva in New York called Shal Yoshev. One of the Rebbeim in Shal Yoshev is Rabbi Green. Like a schmacky yid, I happen to know him personally, a very geschmacka person. And he was telling over a story that once as he was driving down the streets of New York, I don't know if you know the Far Rockaway area, but there's a lot of potholes in the street over there. It's not the smoothest ride. He banged into some pothole on the ground and he ended up getting a flat tire. So what do you do when you get a flat tire? Call AAA. He calls AAA, and a Hispanic fellow in his 60s jumps out of the AAA car and he comes running over to the car to see what the problem is. Introduces himself, his name is Donnie, and suddenly this Hispanic fellow begins speaking Yiddish to Rabbi Green. Rabbi Green is very surprised. He says, are you Jewish? He says, no, I'm not Jewish. He says, if you don't mind telling me, where did you learn Yiddish from? He said, I'll tell you, Rabbi, it's a long story, but I used to be a police officer for the NYPD. And one of the things that I had to do was sometimes guard the Jews during their events. I used to guard one of your big rabbis over there. He said, really? Who is that? He says, you know that big rabbi, Rabbi Yoel Teitelbaum? He said, the Satmar Rebbe? That Rabbi Yoel Teitelbaum? He said, yeah, the Satmar Rebbe, that's the one. I used to be one of his undercover bodyguards. He says, you were an undercover bodyguard? Yes, they used to dress me up in the Hasidic garb, and I had a beard and a payas, and I would stand near, around where the Rebbe was, always looking to see if there were any suspicious individuals, and of course I had to push back the Hasidim as well from getting too close to the Rebbe. So Rabbi Green was very amused by this, and he said, can I ask you a question? How would you recognize a suspicious fellow if he's there amongst all the Hasidim? He said, Rabbi, that was easy, he said. He said, oh, you guys, your heads are always down and always in books. If I ever saw a Hasid hanging around who was up, staring around, looking around and looking at things and didn't have his head down, I knew it was either one of two things. Either this guy doesn't take his learning seriously, or he must be an imposter. And that's how I used to catch the imposters that were there trying to do bad things. Then Donnie the Hispanic looks at Rabbi Green and he says, Rabbi, you know what a Yiddish cup is? So Rabbi Green said, yes, of course I know what a Yiddish cup is. What's a Yiddish cup? A Yiddish cup means that Jewish people, they have good brains, have good heads, they think well, deep penetrating minds, very understanding people. And at this moment, this fellow, Donnie, who had been very jovial the entire time, his face gets very serious. And he says, Rabbi, can I ask you a question? He says, sure. He said, I learned a little bit of the history of your people. And I understand that about 2,000 years ago, you used to live in the holy city of Jerusalem. Yes. And you used to have something called the Beis HaMikdash, the Holy Temple. Yes. And everybody was there, and Hashem himself was dwelling there amongst you. Isn't that true? And he said, yes. And he said, but I learned that because that you hated each other and didn't get along with one another for no reason, so Hashem destroyed the temple and sent you into exile. Is that true? And Rabbi Green said, yes. It is. So he looks at him and he says, Rabbi, can I ask you a question? If you have such a Yiddish cup, why can't the Jewish people just learn to get along with one another and love each other? Then this mess of your exile would end already. And Rabbi Green thought to himself, he's right. And I have no answer to answer him. Perhaps tonight is a little bit of the answer that we need for this time of the year. It's not just for the 3 weeks, the 9 days, Tisha B'Av. It's an avodah, it's an exercise that a person has to work on all year long. And that is I want to develop inside of myself Ayin Tovah. You know, when you go what's the eye doctor? Optometrist. Thank you. You know, when you go to the optometrist and they put those machine on your eyes, A or B? A or B? C. A or C? What are they trying to figure out? They're trying to figure out how to get your eyesight as clean and as pure and as precise as it possibly can be. May we be zeichei im yirtzeh Hashem that as we work on this midah of Ayin Tovah, that our vision becomes so clear and so precise that we are so overwhelmed with all the chasadim that HaKadosh Baruch Hu does for each of us as individuals, and we look only at the brachas that our friends have and our family and our peers and people around us, and we rejoice for them, we are happy for them, chas v'chalila, to get jealous of them, to worry and to get angry with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to get angry with them. And in that way we can have a refuah from this terrible machla of Sinas Chinam. And then HaKadosh Baruch will bring each and every one of Klal Yisrael together ba'achdus. That's the only way that it's going to work, is if we're all together as one, nena from each other, joyous and appreciating the value of one another. And in that zechus, im yitz Hashem, we should be zeicher this Tisha B'Av, not to have to sit on the floor, chas v'chalila, but rather to come together as one ba'achdus, singing and dancing, of course, with the mechitza down the middle for the men and the women, to Yerushalayim Ir HaKodesh, b'mheira v'yameinu. Any questions? Small group tonight, so we can... Anyone? Everybody has such ayin tov over here, so there's probably nothing to talk about. Okay, hatzlocha.